This is Scoop Walker on Grill 'em for God with Pastor Mark to talk about understanding the Bible.
Thanks, Scoop. That's Mike.
Right, Mitch. Let's talk about John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now, exactly what does that mean?
Well, Scoop, it says that God loved the world so much.
No. What does it really mean?
I think the passage is clear, Scoop.
Our listening audience wants to know the hidden meaning.
I think you're trying to read more into it than you need to. God gave his message in simple-to-understand language.
But isn't it significant that every third letter spells Forgoblotten? That's Swedish for cold spaghetti. That means something!
Will you just read the passage?
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. A message from Lifeline Productions. 1-800-523-8669. LifelinePro.com.
Good morning, this is Radio Good News. The goal of this program is to draw all people to the love of Jesus Christ. I want everyone to know and experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are key to a Holy Spirit-filled and successful Christian life. I will focus on God's love because God's love is wonderful. I'm John Thornton. You can write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota, 57101. I'll be reading from the Bible, the New Revised Standard Version, and let's begin today with Psalm 68, verses 1 through 16. Let God rise up, let his enemies be scattered. Let those who hate him flee before him. As smoke is driven away, so drive them away. As wax melts before the fire, let the wicked perish before God. But let the righteous be joyful. Let them exult before God. Let them be jubilant with joy. Sing to God. Sing praises to his name. Lift up a song to him who rides upon the clouds. His name is the Lord. Be excellent before him. O Father of orphans and protector of widows, is God in his holy habitation. God gives the desolate a home to live in. He leads out the prisoners to prosperity. But the rebellious live in a parched land. O God, when you went out before your people, when you marched through the wilderness, the earth quaked, the heavens poured down rain. At the presence of God, the God of Sinai, at the presence of God, the God of Israel, rain in abundance, O God. You showered abroad. You restored your heritage when it languished. Your flock found a dwelling in it. In your goodness, O God, you provided for the needy. The Lord gives the command. Great is the company of those who bore the tidings. The kings of the armies, they flee. The women at home divide the spoil, though they stay among the sheepfold. The wings of a dove covered with silver, its pinions with green gold. When the Almighty scattered kings there, snow fell on Zalmon. O mighty mountain, mountain of Bashan, O many-peaked mountain, mountain of Bashan, why do you look with envy, O many-peaked mountain, at the mount that God desired for his abode, where the Lord will reside forever? Those are God's words from Psalm 68, verses 1 through 16. Our musical guest today is Michelle Toombs.
Seek out my soul.
That was Michelle Toombs, and we'll hear from her again at the end of the program. Stay tuned for that. Turn with me, if you can, to 1 Timothy chapter 5. Do not speak harshly to an older man, but speak to him as to a father, to younger men as brothers, to older women as mothers, to younger women as sisters with absolute purity. Honor widows who are really widows. If a widow has children or grandchildren, they should first learn their religious duty to their own family and make some repayment to their parents, for this is pleasing in God's sight. The real widow, left alone, has set her hope on God and continues in supplications and prayers night and day. But the widow who lives for pleasure is dead, even while she lives. Give these commands as well, so that they may be above reproach. And whoever does not provide for relatives, and especially for family members, has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Let a widow be put on the list if she is not less than 60 years old and has been married only once. She must be well attested for her good works, as one who has brought up children, shown hospitality, washed the saints' feet, helped the afflicted, and devoted herself to doing good in every way. But refuse to put younger widows on the list, for when their sensual desires alienate them from Christ, they want to marry, and so they incur condemnation for having violated their first pledge. Besides that, they learn to be idle, gadding about from house to house, and they are not merely idle, but also gossips and busybodies, saying what they should not say. So I would have younger widows marry, bear children, and manage their households, so as to give the adversary no occasion to revile us. For some have already turned away to follow Satan. If any believing woman has relatives who are really widows, let her assist them. Let the church not be burdened, so that it can assist those who are real widows. Let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. For the scripture says, "You shall not muzzle an ox while it is treading out the grain," and "The laborer deserves to be paid." Never accept any accusation against an elder except on the evidence of two or three witnesses. As for those who persist in sin, rebuke them in the presence of all, so that the rest may also stand in fear. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus and of the elect angels, I warn you to keep these instructions without prejudice, doing nothing on the basis of partiality. Do not ordain anyone hastily, and do not participate in the sins of others. Keep yourself pure. No longer drink only water, but take a little wine for the sake of your stomach and your frequent ailments. The sins of some people are conspicuous and precede them to judgment, while the sins of others follow them there. So also good works are conspicuous, and even when they are not, they cannot remain hidden. Those are God's words from 1 Timothy chapter 5. And the widow Wilson was raising her 12 children all alone, so she decided that she would visit the dating service and find a new husband. The dating service asked her what was the one characteristic that she desired in a new husband. The widow Wilson considered her 12 kids and immediately answered, "Moderation." Today, I'm going to talk about families. Did you have a family? Most people did. How was your family? Was it a blessed and wonderful group of people? Or was it the photo of those people in the dictionary under the term dysfunctional? Families. Paul knows about families. In 1 Timothy chapter 5, he discusses that. But before examining what was said about families, let us remember the background. This letter was written by Paul in about the year 65 AD. It is inspired by God and is truly valuable for teaching and study. Some critics doubt the authenticity of this document, but they are wrong. 1 Timothy was written by Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the command of God our Savior and of Christ Jesus our hope, to Timothy, his loyal child in the faith. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. People can reject God's word, but they cannot escape God's judgment. In Matthew 12, 36 through 37, we read, "I tell you, on the day of judgment, you will have to give an account for every careless word you utter. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. Timothy was a great example of Christian faith. He was the son of a Christian lady named Eunice, and his grandmother was Lois, a wonderful lady who converted to Christianity, for when Jesus came, the Messiah was here. In verse 8 is the central passage for chapter 5. Whoever does not provide for relatives, and especially for family members, has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. But Paul also talks much about the care of families that the church should offer. This is because, as Christian people, we are part of two families. One is our family of origin, our moms and dads and siblings and whatnot. The other is our spiritual family. Now, some people really have a rotten family. I have known that people came out of a really screwed up family background, and it amazes me, and I believe it's an undeniable miracle of God, that people can come from a terrible family and turn out rather normal and healthy. Yes, indeed, some people's family are more like characters in a Tennessee Williams play. Did you ever feel like your siblings were a Laura, engrossed in a fantasy world of glass menageries and old musical tunes? Or did you ever live with a brutal man like Stanley Kowalski? Indeed, was your family more like the Waltons, or like the Bundys, or the Simpsons, or the Ricardos? How was your family of origin? Family can be tough, very tough. Paul gives us a handle on how to interact with people. He says, "Do not speak harshly to an older man, but speak to him as to a father, to younger men as brothers, to older women as mothers, to younger women as sisters, with absolute purity." Now, believe me, there have been times in my life when I had to interact with some crusty and mean old people. That is hard. I spent 2 years working part-time in a nursing home, and I personally observed the very best and the very worst of elderly men and women. It is hard to treat them like a beloved parent. But as Christian people, we need to show love to everyone else, especially to those who are elderly and facing the end of their earthly lives. When I was a nurse, I worked for many years at the Veterans Hospital with older men. This taught me much about life. I saw many different types of families and a huge myriad of ways family members interact. Sometimes the father was just plain scum. Other times the family treated the man terribly. And on some rare occasions I observed really good families. Now, some might say that we should use our earthly fathers as an example to how to speak to an older man. Speak to them as you would to your own father. Now, this is pretty good advice, except if your own father had lived a crummy life. There are some men who have been toxic influences on their children. Indeed, being a father can be very hard. In the Bible, there are few examples of good earthly fathers. Let's consider. Lot was a horrible father. Eli was a horrible father. David was a poor example, and his lack of leadership in his own family led to a national rebellion and war. King Saul seems to have done something well in raising Jonathan. The best example of a father in Scripture is the New Testament Joseph. He is a great father. So interacting with older men can be hard. We just do not have enough good role models of fathers. But the Bible is filled with excellent role models of mothers. Naomi was a great mother to her sons, and especially to her daughter-in-law Ruth. Hannah was a wonderful mother to her son Samuel. And of course, Mary was an especially excellent mother to her son Jesus. So we must be respectful and honoring toward all the elderly people we encounter. Just remember, when we are loving toward the older women and men we know, that is kind of like honoring our own mothers and fathers. God blesses those kinds of good deeds. Paul instructs us not only about how to interact with elderly men and women, but also tells us how to take care of young men and women. This basically covers all people. Speak to young men as brothers, to a young woman as a sister. Is this easy to do? It is hard as well, just as hard and perhaps harder than caring for the elderly. Should we look to the biblical examples of how siblings interacted? Should we be brothers like Cain and Abel? That probably would not work out well. Or perhaps Jacob and Esau? No, not that example either. Perhaps Isaac and Ishmael? No, their descendants are still killing each other. Or remember how the brothers treated the Old Testament Joseph? Or perhaps like Absalom and Amnon. Yuck! This is not to mention how terrible some of the brothers treated their own sisters. Those interactions were hideous. Let's see, there were rapes and murders and lies and abuse all around. And those families are written up in the Bible. Yes, in the Bible, there are few examples of how to live out brotherly love. So again, we see how the Bible is really true and accurate to real life. For the families described in the Bible were real people with real problems who often really messed up. So what are we to do? How do we live out what Paul writes in verse 8? Whoever does not provide for relatives and especially for family members has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Well, this comes back to the two families that Christians inhabit, our earthly family and our spiritual family. The spiritual family gives us advice on how to deal with the earthly family. Jesus Christ, our Master and Messiah, said, as recorded in Matthew 7, verse 12, "In everything, do to others as you would have them do to you. For this is the law and the prophets." Yes, the golden rule applies. This is not just a New Testament command, but is based upon the true meaning of the Old Testament as well. For in Isaiah 58, 6 through 8, we read, "Is this not the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice? To undo the thongs of the yoke? To let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? And when you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard." Paul brings up the issue of widows. This is very interesting. Paul enhances the position of women. This is God speaking through Paul. And God spoke through James in James 1:27 when he wrote, "Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world." In the Old Testament times, the Hebrews treated women much as property. A female started out by having rights only as a man's daughter. Then the woman only had rights as the wife of a man. If that couple then had sons and the son grew up and became of legal age, which was usually about 13 years old, then that woman gained rights as the mother of that man. If a woman's husband died before the sons were of legal age, she was considered a widow and her children were orphans. Can you imagine that situation? Or consider a 13-year-old boy having the legal status as a man and leader of his 30-year-old mom? Indeed, women had almost no legal rights, but God sees the plight of widows. In Exodus 22:22, we read, "You shall not abuse any widow or orphan." In Deuteronomy 27:19, we read, "Cursed be anyone who deprives the alien, the orphan, and the widow of justice." In Zechariah 7:9-10, we read, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, render true judgments, show kindness and mercy to one another. Do not oppress the widow, the orphan, the alien, or the poor, and do not devise evil in your hearts against one another." So here in 1 Timothy chapter 5, Paul is taking up that call to care for widows. God inspired Paul to pen that widows had rights and entitlements from both the physical family and the spiritual family. If any believing women have relatives who are really widows, let them assist the women. Let the church not be burdened, so that it can assist those who are real widows, the ones without any other means of support. The spiritual family, meaning the Christian church, has a duty to assist. This is what is meant by being put on the list. The church will support that woman. Paul gives a set of criteria. He writes, "Let a widow be put on the list if she is not less than 60 years old and has been married only once. She must be well attested for her good works, as one who has brought up children, shown hospitality, washed the saints' feet, helped the afflicted, and devoted herself to doing good in every way." Then Paul limited who was eligible. "Refuse to put younger widows on the list, for when their sensual desires alienate them from Christ, they want to marry, and so they incur condemnation for having violated their first pledge. Paul is saying that young women should remarry and continue to have children and be part of the community. Paul knows that women will still need family support, and he encourages the Christian men to consider marriage to one of those young widows. Paul warns that if the widows are not part of a community, they may become idle, chattering about from house to house. And they are not merely idle, but gossips and busybodies, saying what they should not say. Indeed, younger widows should marry, bear children, and manage their households so as to give the adversary no occasion to revile us. Then Paul warns Timothy that some have already turned away to follow Satan. Here again, that ugly head of the female cult at Ephesus peeks out. Some of the women who had become widows were joining that perverted cult and were acting as temple prostitutes. Paul knows that that kind of activity is satanic. He warns Timothy about it. So as all Christians, we should have a duty to tend to the needs of others, especially elderly people and widows. We need to tend to the people in our churches who are hurting and struggling. For whoever does not provide for relatives, and especially for family members, has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. So, my friends, as a Christian, you do have a duty, you have an obligation to meet the physical needs of your own family and your church family. You have the duty and obligation to meet the needs of your spiritual brothers and sisters in the church, for you have two families. Take good care of them. Indeed, I like the way James puts this. Let's repeat James 1:27. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. Is your religion pure? You never know when you're going to meet someone who needs your care. The time was World War II, almost 60 years ago. Ellie was just out of high school. She was captured and put in a concentration camp because she was Jewish. The camp was evil beyond description. Death was everywhere. Ellie endured months and months of abuse and near starvation, but she knew she must escape. She planned her escape carefully. On the night of her escape, she maneuvered around all the obstacles until all that was left was the huge barbed wire fence at the perimeter of the camp. She was about halfway up the fence when she heard a guard angrily calling her. She screamed and fell to the ground. She found herself at gunpoint. Her legs were covered with lots of cuts and scratches from the barbed wire. She thought her only means of escape had ended. To her astonishment, she heard the guard say, "Ellie? Ellie, is that you? It cannot possibly be. Is that really you, Ellie?" As Ellie looked up at the guard, she realized that it was Rolf, a former classmate and her best friend from middle school. They had shared many conversations and ideas, and they had dreamed together. Once they had been very close. Nonetheless, Ellie was still filled with despair. She said, "Oh, Rolf, just go ahead and shoot me, please. I have no reason to live. I've lost all hope. Get it over with now and just shoot me. There's nothing left to live for." Rolf responded and said, "Oh, Ellie, you are so wrong. There is everything to live for. So long as you know who to live for, I shall let you go. I will guard you until you get over the wire and on your way. But you must promise me one thing." Ellie listened intently. "What is it, Rolf?" Rolf said to her, "Promise me that after you get free, you will ask one question continuously until someone answers it for you. You must ask, why does Jesus Christ make life worth living? Promise me, Ellie, Jesus is the only reason to live. Promise me. You will ask that question until you get the answer." "Yes, yes, I promise." Ellie furiously climbed the barbed wire fence and thought to herself, "I'd promise anything. Get out of here." As she dropped to the ground and ran to the woods, Ellie heard several shots fired behind her. Glancing back, she saw that it was not Rolf who had fired the shots, but it was another camp guard who had seen Rolf allowing Ellie to climb over the wire. The guards had shot Rolf dead. As Ellie ran to her freedom, it occurred to her that it was Rolf who had died to allow her to escape and had just wanted her to ask people, "Why does Jesus Christ make life worth living?" I'm John Thornton. Thanks for listening to Radio Good News. I encourage you to seek out a church family where you can worship, be encouraged, and celebrate the love that God has for you. May you richly know the blessings of the God who was, the God who is, and the God who is to come again. We'll finish today with Michelle Toombs.
Blessings flow that run from heaven to here below. Known forever, refuge from your foes, who cloud your hope and chain your woes. Known forever, yours. May all the blessings flow that run from heaven. Receive his blessings.